Sri Raghavendra's Miracles in Chittaldru. The similarities we would be examining now should truly be amazing. Just as Sri Raghavendra had indicated a place in Manchala and had asked Diwan Venkanna to have it dug up, Sri Sumatindra too tells Ragappa to get the earth excavated at a spot shown by him in Chitradurga. More explicitly, the grandson of Sri Raghavendra's Purvashrama elder brother tells Ragappa, the grandson of Sri Raghavendra's disciple Venkanna, to dig up at the spot enlightened to him by Sri Raghavendra in his dream. Sri Raghavendra, through his extraordinary spiritual powers and keen insight, identifies the place where he had performed yajna as Prahlada in an earlier birth and gets Manchala village as a gift, subsequently ordaining that a particular spot shown by him be dug up. Likewise, he enlightens Sri Sumatindra in his dream to ferret out a particular place, knowing the existence of holy vigrahas in the inner recesses of the earth. In Mantralaya, Sri Raghavendra had entrusted Diwan Venkanna to get the Brindavana for him installed at that place. And in Chitradurga, he ordains Sri Sumatindra to leave at that place the Brindavana fashioned by him, Sri Raghavendra. The public of Chitradurga felt joyous at examining all such likenessness to the happenings at their place and were eagerly awaiting Sri Sumatindra's explications about the idols retrieved from the earth. There was a big gathering at the place in the evening. Sri Sumatindra started his Anugraha Vachana saying, "Dear devotees, the happenings at this holy Chitradurga in the last 2 days are really wondrous. This must be the place where Sri Rama should have set his holy foot upon in the Treta Yuga. Besides, Sri Anjaneya should also have been present here then with Sri Rama. Later in the Dwapara Yuga, the Panchapandavas had lived here for a long time. In the Treta Yuga, Sri Vayu Bhagavan had taken avatara as Hanuman and done Ramaseva. In the Dwapara Yuga, he had taken the Bhima avatara and served Sri Krishna. The Kali Yuga has seen his avatara as Sri Madhva, who is still doing service to Sri Vedavyasa in Upper Badri. In the Dwapara Yuga, when he was living here as Bhima, as one among the Panchapandavas, he could get recollections of his earlier birth and thus crafted an idol of Sri Rama, whom he had been worshipping devoutly in the earlier avatara, to which he started performing puja too with his brothers. Besides, he also created an idol of Sri Krishna, whom he had been worshipping in person in his mundane birth and started doing puja to it with his siblings. It is those two Panchaloka icons that have been unearthed yesterday and today. Yes, please now have a look at this Anjaneya idol, which is the one that had been worshipped by the Panchapandavas. Bhima had crafted also a stone idol of Sri Rama's ambassador Hanuman, which was his earlier avatara, and to signify the Panchapandavas having worshipped that sacred idol, Hanuman's tail had been adorned with 5 bells, sculptured beautifully in that portion of the idol. The Saugantika flower that Bhima had brought for Draupadi is sculptured as being held in the left hand, and the right hand raised above is like extending his blessings to everyone. A unique presentation indeed. It is Sri Raghavendra and Sri Anjaneya who enlightened me about these idols and guided me for their retrieval from the place of their concealment. Indubitably, these icons will be ensconced here in Chitradurga itself. Let the grace of Sri Harivayu Guru be bestowed on you all. Narayana, Narayana, concluded the Swami to the acclamation of the huge gathering there. Later, Sri Sumatindra, on an auspicious day, installed and consecrated there the Anjaneya idol to which the Panchapandavas had performed puja to in the Dwapara Yuga. There being no Garbhagriha or temple, the miniature Mritika Brindavana, together with the idols of Sri Rama and Sri Krishna, were given to an orthodox person of that place, with the advice. Let these be kept in your puja room every morning in an orthodox manner, in muddy, that is, in an unpolluted way. Keep these Rama, Krishna icons and the Brindavana besides the Anjaneya idol, and perform Abhisheka to all the idols, and following that, do the Abhisheka to the Mritika Brindavana also. Thereafter, offering the daily Hastodaka to the deities and the gurus. After completing the daily worship in this manner, take them back to your house to be brought the next day for puja here. A few days later, the Swami left Chitradurga on Sanchara. The orthodox Brahmin and several pandits of good Vedic learning following him adhered to the practice set up during the visit of Sri Sumatindra, which continued for about 250 years uninterruptedly. Around 1962, Sri Sumayendra Tirtha, the then Pitadhipati of Sri Raghavendra Math, visited Chitradurga once. He was enraptured at the sight of the alluring Brindavana that the earlier pontiffs, starting with Sri Raghavendra and ending with Sri Sumatindra, had devoutly carried with them to the various places they had travelled to. He was transported with great joy when he beheld the icons and the stone vigraha that had been unearthed there. The pontiff thought then that Sri Raghavendra Swami's Mritika Brindavana should also be installed at that place, and as such set in train the arrangements for it. A stone Brindavana was thus sculpted, and only the auspicious day for its installation and consecration remained to be decided about. But somehow Sri Suyamindra was ill at ease and therefore examined the Brindavana meticulously. And to his dismay, he found a crack in the Brindavana and thought that it was improper to consecrate the Raghavendra Mritika in a Brindavana with a defect. It was also perplexing to him as to how he can leave the Brindavana fashioned for the consecration of the Mritika of Sri Raghavendra in as-is-various condition. He left for Mantralaya later, instructing that the defective Brindavana be kept in a closed pit below the earth. He then prayed to Sri Guru Raja to do some alternative arrangement at Chitradurga and was eagerly awaiting enlightenment from him. Time passed on, and after a few years, he bestowed Sannyasa Ashrama on Sri Sujayindra. It was later in 1967 that Sri Suyamindra entered his Brindavana at Mantralaya. Sri Sujayindra, during his religious tour thereafter, came to Chitradurga and recalled there what Sri Suyamindra had told him earlier. He prayed, "Guru Raja, it's not known when you will ensconce yourself at this place." And despite the passage of many years, the Mritika Brindavana did not become a reality in Chitradurga. The Swami then concluded that it was best to wait until Sri Guru Raja gave the signal himself. In 1983, Sri Sujayindra initiated Sri Sushamindra into Sannyasa Ashrama at Bhikshalaya. Sri Sushamindra was eager to visit Chitradurga immediately after taking to Sannyasa, for that was the place he had lived at a tender age, under the care of his mother. Later, during his visit to Chitradurga, after seeing the rare vigrahas of Rama, Krishna and Anjaneya, and having darshan of the Brindavana crafted by Sri Raghavendra, he foretold emphatically after his japa that Sri Raghavendra would be making his advent there very soon. Sri Sushamindra then supplicated to Sri Sujayindra that he should pave the way for Sri Raghavendra making his advent in Chitradurga in his Mritika Rupa. Sri Sujayindra indulged in deep meditation for some time. And when he came back to his normal state, said, "Sushamindra, make all arrangements necessary for the installation. Sri Raghavendra has given the permission for going ahead with it. Sri Guru Raja can be escorted there in his Mritika Rupa and the formal Pratishtapana done there." Sri Sushamindra became ecstatic and hastened to send this message to Chitradurga. Arrangements for the installation and consecration then started in full swing. It was baffling to Sri Sujayindra as to what should be done with the Brindavana sculpted during the period of Sri Suyamindra. whether a new Brindavana could be erected over the old one or the defective one should be moved aside and the Mritika consecrated in a new Brindavana, keeping it in its place. The old one, even if taken out from below the earth, cannot be used, and therefore having recourse to it as a foundation for the new one, whether the latter could be erected above the ground level or the old one could be left undisturbed at the same place, were some questions that arose then, defying immediate answers. It was also puzzling as to where the miniature Brindavana fashioned by Sri Raghavendra should be placed. When such thoughts were confounding everyone, the Pune incident of 1971 flashed in the mind of Sri Sujindra, brightening his face and infusing the confidence that such a thing could be done, as accomplished in Pune. Yes, in Pune, Sri Sujindra had installed Sri Raghavendra's Mritika Brindavana on the Brindavana of Sri Varadendra, as detailed in Part 7. Likewise, at Chitradurga, Sri Sujindra thought of setting on Sri Raghavendra's Mritika Brindavana the miniature Brindavana crafted by Sri Raghavendra Swami himself. Accordingly, on 13th June 1986, the Raghavendra Mritika Brindavana was installed at Chitradurga by the holy hands of Sri Sujindra in the august presence of the Peetadhipatis of Sode Math and Puttige Math, at which auspicious event Sri Sushimindra also was present. The Brindavana of Sri Suyamindra's period had been since long kept in concealment at the spot at which the Rama, Krishna and Anjaneya idols had been found. Above that Brindavana, at the ground level, the Brindavana for Sri Raghavendra was set up and the Mritika Pratishtavana done therein. The miniature Brindavana to which Sri Raghavendra had been performing puja was installed above that, over which, on the hind side, the Anjaneya to which the Panchapandavas had done puja was set, thus presenting a unique sight to those beholding that wonder. It's indeed amazing that we are able to have darshan in Chitradurga of the idols of deities that had got buried in the inner recesses of the earth at the end of the Dwapara Yuga. The archaeological research into the possible evidences of the Dwaraka city created by Sri Krishna having gone under the sea are still on, and it can be surmised that at some point of time the city of gold may emerge out of the depths of the sea, just like the idols of the Dwapara Yuga that have come out in Chitradurga from inside the mass of the earth. A Tulasi Vana of Chitradurga is now a marriage hall. It is said that around 1995, a silver pot of salagramas and padukas separately were found at this holy place. Sri Raghavendra Math at this place is located in the row opposite the place where Sri Raghavendra had caused his disciple attaining the moksha. A fort with 7 ingresses atop a hill and the Sri Krishna installed by Janamejaya can also be seen at this place, all in a few hours. Chitaldurga Fort is a tourist spot now. On the Bangalore-Belgaum highway, Chitradurga is at a distance of 198 km. The road route is Bangalore-Tumkur, Sira-Hiryur, Chitradurga. Further travel along this route will lead to Davangere, Harihar, Haveri, Hubli, Dharwad, Belgaum. Punyasthala and Honnali, covered in Part 6, are proximate to Chitradurga. There are some important locales near Shimoga, which could be visited from Chitradurga, travelling via Holkere, Chinnagiri, Bhadravati, Shimoga. We are also to see about all those places later in this writing. We have already seen that Sri Raghavendra had done puja to the Mritikas of his gurus placed in the miniature Brindavana created by him. It may arouse one's curiosity as to whose Mritikas would have been placed inside that Brindavana. Undoubtedly, Sri Sudhindra Tirtha's Mritika, being his gurus, would have been consecrated inside. And so too the Mritikas of all other exalted personages of the Navabrindavana. Likewise, those of Sri Narahari Tirtha entombed on the bank of the Tungabhadra in Anegundi, as also of Sri Raghunandana, The Paramaguru of Sri Vijayendra Smritika from Kumbakonam, Solayappan Street, Moola Brindavana would have also been placed inside, as also those of many other great ones. A visit to Sri Chitradurga will therefore confer the benefit of having the darshan of Sri Rama, Krishna, Anjaneya and Sri Raghavendra in Mritikarupa, apart from a darshan of the miniature Brindavana containing the Mritika of several gurus of the distant past, thus getting graced by all those deities and the spiritually exalted ones present there in Mritikarupa. Sri Raghavendra, if he had so desired, could have retrieved the idols of Sri Rama, Krishna and Anjaneya from below the earth and installed them in Chitradurga during his mundane existence. It should not therefore be incorrect to conclude that it was his intent to grace Sri Sumatindra that privilege and honour during his pontificate. The incident reveals emphatically that Sri Raghavendra is still alive in Mantralaya Moola Brindavana and orchestrating things in the mundane world. Sri Raghavendra, instead of telling Sri Sumatindra in his dream to leave the miniature Brindavana in Chitraldur, could have caused him to install in that place the Vigrahas found there, along with the Brindavana sculpted by him. But he did not enlighten him that way. The miniature Brindavana and the Vigrahas retrieved had been worshipped in Puja by several Pitadhipatis after Sri Sumatindra, but none of them had been singled out for the honour of installing them. Even Sri Suyamindra's efforts at Pratishtabana having proved futile. It's with this backdrop it needs to be examined why the Pratishtabana was graced to be performed only during the period of Sri Sujindra and Sri Sushimindra. Yes, Sri Sushimindra, who had frolicked as a child in Chitaldrug, was made to go there when he became a Pitadhipati, where the seed for the Pratishtabana was sown in his heart, which later became a reality through the holy hands of Sri Sujindra during his period in his very presence. And undoubtedly, this has been engineered by Sri Raghavendra himself, who does such leelas, alive as he is in his Brindavana, even today. When placing one's faith in the powers of Sri Raghavendra, patient waiting for results is absolutely necessary. Sri Guru Raja is the one who is aware of our past and knows how he should extend his grace to us. It's within his knowledge what sort of impediments would come in our way and how he should grace their removal and cause beneficial results to us. Of course, we may have to experience some hardship in the process of his causing the eradication of those, but it has to be borne stoically. The mental attunement for it is to be cultivated, and such a trait will channelize our punya or merits even to our progeny, bringing forth Sri Raghavendra's grace in a full measure. In fine, waiting patiently is a sine qua non to recap one's fruit. In substantiation of this, we are to examine the events at another place connected with Sri Sumatindra. It will lay bare how Sri Guru Raja manipulates affairs and causes things to happen at the appropriate time, making everyone wait for the result.